A guy walks into a bar, and he's got a frog on his head. The bartender says, "What's up with that?" And the frog says, "I don't know, man. This started out as a wart on my butt." I'm Ansi McLean, and this is Resisting Enlightenment. This is the podcast that unwisely revisits our most awkward, embarrassing moments and offers nothing but the impotent act of commiseration. This episode, I talk with my buddy Spoons about girls, fear, and the glorious masculinity of John Davidson.
Hey everybody, it's Resisting Enlightenment.
Were you afraid of girls?
Oh God, yes. Yeah,
why?
Absolutely.
Why?
I don't know. They were so different. They were so different from me.
They
just
are
alien.
Girls are very different than
you know?
Boys.
Yeah.
That's so true.
Yeah.
So
I mean,
true.
Well, I mean, you know, you just knew at an early age. It was like, okay, so that dude over there, that guy's kind of a bully, you know, and that dude over there, he seems kind of cool, you know, but that girl over there, she could destroy me if I say the wrong word. You just know,
yeah.
You know,
and
like, oh my
probably
God.
Probably has.
Yeah, absolutely.
Did that ever happen to you? Did a girl cut you to the core with words or a look or something that made you fearful in any way?
Yeah. It was more probably, you know, as you get older, you go, I was probably my own insecurities or whatever,
sure.
You know. But
sure.
Boy, as a kid, boy, those things mean so much.
It was real.
Know? Yeah.
I mean, I had some really embarrassing moments, times where girls looked at me like I was just a weirdo. And every nerd has moments like that when they can say, you know, that was the moment I got into Dungeons and Dragons, you know, or whatever. I was afraid of girls in like a big way.
Okay.
And I'm not really sure why.
Hmm. Have you ever said the wrong thing? Like
yes.
The wrong words came out,
yes.
And that was the last thing she ever heard. And
yeah.
You just went, oh my God, I just screwed this up.
Yeah.
I hope I get a chance to do this over
yeah,
and explain
right.
What it was that I was
how
really
many
trying
times?
To say.
Yeah. Now this is a story about
saying the wrong thing and really not getting the opportunity to do it over, to explain
right.
What it was that you were really trying to say.
Right. Okay, so yeah. I asked a girl named Sarah, not her real name. Okay, I asked Sarah out, went to my high school, and we were friends. And I got up the nerve to say, you know, hey, what are you doing this Friday night? But see, I was so nervous and awkward talking to girls. It had to be masked in something. And so this is the late 70s, and Steve Martin is the shit. Okay, so all of us could imitate Steve Martin at the drop of a hat. Everybody had this stuff memorized, you know, switching his shoulders back and forth, going, oh, no, you know, that sort of thing. And so in order to ask this a Sarah gal out, I had to mimic Steve Martin in order to get through my shtick,
yeah,
which I had rehearsed. I'd asked a few girls out and it didn't go well. And this was just another attempt. And, you know, and so I just went up to her. It was Monday or Tuesday and said, you know, hey, I think you and me need to go out on the town. And she was like, yeah, I think we should too. You know, it's like recognizing the Steve Martin thing.
Yeah.
And we was just back and forth for a few minutes there in the hallway in between classes. Hey, all right. You know, so, hey, pick you up Friday? She's like, yeah, you bet. Pick me up Friday, 6 p.m. Yeah, woo, all right. You know, and I don't even know if anything was that nailed down. Like,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Friday was mentioned. And so I'm like, okay, cool. That went well. And we both kind of giggled off, you know. And Thursday rolls up.
Okay.
And I've told all my friends about this, right? I mean, like most of my friends know that I'm taking this Sarah out on Friday. I'm nervous and everything. I cleaned my car, man. I detailed my car. That's serious.
It's huge.
Yeah, that's huge.
As if a teenager, that's huge.
You know, I spent a good 6 hours, you know, cleaning my car up. So I was that excited about, you know, the date. And so Thursday at school rolls up, and I wait till the afternoon. I'm not going to, like, you know, I'm not going to, like, harass her, you know, by constantly reminding her that we have a date for Friday. You know, I'm going to be cool about this.
Oh, yeah.
But I go up to her and I go, hey, so I'm pulling this Steve Martin because that's where we left off with all that, right?
That's and where I'm you like, bonded.
Yeah, right. Bonded, so I'm Steve. Like, oh, that's how I asked her out. So I want to pick up on that right now. So, hey, so hey, pick you up Friday, pick you up tomorrow, 5 o'clock. You know, hey, all right. I'm a wild and crazy guy. You know? And she gets this, like, she freezes and looks at me. And she's looking at all my body language and looking in my face and looking in my eyes and then back to the body language. And
man.
And she looks at me and she goes, were you serious?
Oh, God.
I'm at my dad's this weekend.
And at the moment she says that,
what was the
feeling?
This is... you know, the tears of a clown thing, but I'm like, you know, I'm like going, okay, so inside I'm dying, inside I'm crushed, you know, I'm like, oh crap, okay, all right, I get it. But outside I'm like, I immediately, like right on the heels of her, I'm like, I got you. Yeah, I got you, I got you. And she's like relieved and laughs, she smacks me on the arm, you know. She says, oh, I should have known better, you know, and just this whole thing. And we laughed about it, did a little more Steve Martin riff with each other. And then she leaves again. And I'm devastated.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. That feeling, man. That feeling of just hopelessness, right? So what did you learn?
You know, I didn't learn a damn thing.
Just do a better impersonation next time.
I started impersonating George Carlin.
Yeah, there
and that
you
worked
go.
A little better for yeah. me, I guess.
You get a different kind of girl with George Carlin's humor.
Right, right.
A little darker, a little more. Yeah. Fatalistic.
Yes, know. There you go.
Ella may, Ella may not. It depends upon her mood that day. Ella may, Ella may not. But Ella may. Got a funny feeling, got a lump in my throat. I'm half afraid of what she might say. I've been the silly fool in this cruel little game she plays. Ella may not, but Ella may. I wanna take her dancing by the light of the stars. She might, it's kind of hard to say. Her moods ebb and flow, come and go with the waves on the bay. Ella may not, but Ella may. She's a blessing in a blue denim dress, like the petals on a daisy. It's just anybody's guess. Ella may not, but Ella may. I don't know why I love her, keeps me walking on eggs. For some crazy reason I stay. You know what I mean if you've seen a baby not get its way. Ella May, LMA now, but LMA, LMA, LMA now, but LMA.
Have you always been like a class clown kind of
person? We've had a couple of matriarchal and beautiful people in our family pass away in the last few years. And when that happens, there's a flurry of family photos that get passed around and shared. And I just love those, you know. So I saw all these pictures of me as a kid, and in every one of them, I'm like, it looks like I'm making somebody laugh or saying something funny for the camera.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's laughing in the photo, so I guess it must have worked, but it was just nice to hear people laugh when I was a kid. I loved my aunt's laughter. I'd be tucked in bed and drifting off and not being able to go to sleep, and I'd hear my grandma, my mom, my aunts out there playing cards and laughing at stories or something. That's kind of like my soul food, you know?
Yeah.
And hearing people laugh and making people laugh is so in my core that I could no more separate that from my need for food or water, you know, or bourbon, just depending.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, I wouldn't say that's a fear of mine, but that's not something that's in my wheelhouse. You know, just being able to just kind of act the fool, you know, jump around and make people laugh in that way.
Well, no, you're humor, man. I mean, you're one of the funniest guys I know.
I do like making people laugh, but the physical comedy side of that.
That's tougher. As you get older.
Well, yeah, there's some limitations to that, I guess, you know.
Yeah.
That's not something in my wheelhouse. I wouldn't want somebody, you know, laughing at me for that reason, you know.
Up in a tree, out on a limb, saying a prayer, singing a hymn, holding on for dear life, the wind like a train in my ears. It's all like a dream. When I was down there, my feet on the ground, the devil may care, but I wouldn't trade a thing for the climb I've been on all these years. I heard all the stories about climbing too high. The wind is too strong, son, you'll fall and you'll die. But nobody mentioned this beautiful view, and words are too weak to describe it to you. The wind does get stronger the higher you go. The branches get shaky, you'll sway to and fro. And each step you take is like walking a tightrope through time. Well, those first few are easy when you're close to the ground. But up here it gets scary and you don't dare look down. We see more, we love more, we risk more the higher we climb. There are people I know, and you know some too. They're not much for climbing or trying anything new. They walk under trees with their eyes cast down. Each step so careful, they're safe on the ground. But we were all climbers when I was a kid. When you lived in a small town, it's just something you did. When puberty hit, priorities changed, no surprise. And my friends all stopped climbing, but that wasn't me. If I liked a girl, I'd help her climb a tall tree. And we'd look out at the horizon, I'd watch the sunset in her eyes. A boy can sure learn a lot about a girl on the branch of a tree at the top of the world. What she holds on to when the wind starts to blow. Is she up for adventure? That's a good thing to know. Up in a tree, out on a limb, saying a prayer, singing a hymn, holding on for dear life, the wind like a train in my ears. Hey, that's living, honey, we're living the dream. Hey, that's living, honey, we're living the dream.
So that's
right.
And that's been my story from the time, as far as I can remember, you know, somebody fumbling, you know, getting in his own way and fumbling through all this stuff.
And certainly, you know, getting in your own way is, yeah, that's a profound idea. If you can acknowledge it, if you know that you're getting in your own way, that's the hard part, right?
Yeah. Then you can fix it.
Right.
If you don't know, if you're not aware,
yeah,
there's nothing you can fix because nothing needs to be fixed as far as you're concerned.
Right.
I'm doing just fine.
Yeah. You're tripping over your own shoelaces. Yeah. You don't even know it.
Yeah. I'm an asshole. Total asshole maybe, but nothing that I see needs to be fixed. You know?
Well, that's what good friends are for. That's why
that's
you need good
friends. That's what friends are for.
Right.
Sorry for that. I am so sorry for that. If that has stuck in anyone's head out there, I apologize.
That was Dionne Warwick, though. That was her part,
it
right?
It was, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And Elton John. And was John Davidson in that?
John Davidson.
That's a little early.
John, okay, so he's still around, right? Yeah. What was that?
Dude.
Wait, wasn't he on, he was on some like That's Incredible? Wasn't that John Davidson? Wasn't he on that?
Oh, I remember that show. Yeah. Maybe I think he hosted it or something.
Yeah. I don't know. We'll have to have
John Davidson.
Fact check.
Look up John Davidson, y'all. Very handsome man. Two of the deepest dimples I've ever seen on a human being.
Yeah.
Yeah. Beautiful man. Beautiful man. Square jaw.
Beautiful John Davidson.
John Davidson had the hair going on.
Man. Dapper man.
Ooh, baby. I'll bet he's probably in his 70s. I'll bet he's still freaking
happening.
Beautiful man.
Yeah.
He wears his shirts open.
Yes. Gold chains?
Yeah,
was John Davidson a gold chain kind of guy?
Yeah. I think he might have had a few. That might have been a little more Bobby Sherman.
I'm going to have to look up a lot of stuff about John Davidson.
But he was also like, you know, he's an actor. He was a musician. He sang, played guitar.
Right. Yeah.
Good old John Davidson. Thank you, John, for your service, for your good work, for giving us all those wonderful hours of wonderful entertainment and narration of That's Incredible. My world in a world that could use more rockin'.
Daddy may have wanted a boy, but I have everything I could want in a woman. What did you think I was singing about? Oh, no, 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 no. A daddy just wanted a boy. A daddy just wanted a boy. Nobody understands but Larry Ann. Larry Ann. Nobody understands. Nobody understands but Larry Ann. Larry Ann. I need a good sing along to.
Larry Ann from my album Living the Dream a few years back. That's a fun track. I still enjoy listening to that. I don't listen to my own music very often, but that's one that can, you know, I can listen all the way through. I had a lot of fun doing that. That's actually the demo recording, which I had, you know, a lot of times an artist will do demos. It might just be simple guitar vocals or whatever. You take it into the studio and let the band hear it, and they chart it, and then everybody works on it. And we did do a studio version of that song. And I just remember listening back weeks later as we were mixing, and I'm like, you know, it doesn't have the punch or the life that the demo had. So I actually just used the demo on the album. And that's me playing everything, the keyboards and the bass and the, you know, lead guitar and everything. It took me hours and hours to do that because I'm not a lead guitar player or a keyboard player for that matter. But it was just fun. And that whole album, Living the Dream, was all but a couple tracks were done like that. It was me under headphones and playing all the instruments. And I had a lot of fun. I really learned a lot about myself as a writer and as a musician working on that album. It's still one of my favorites. And out of what, the 20 albums that I've recorded. Well, I want to thank my buddy Spoons for hanging out with me and sharing all his good mojo once again. He's a busy guy. He's such a good drummer. He's in great demand here in Nashville. And it's hard for us to grab time to do these things, but we always have a good time. And thank you, Spoons. And thanks to the musicians and engineers who make me sound so good on these songs that I play for you. I've worked with hundreds over the past 25 years, and I've learned so much from all of them. The song you heard earlier in the podcast, Ella May, is off my Time Sweetened Lies album. And that awesome piano playing that you hear on that song is my dear friend, Polly Zarb, who now lives and works in England. He's a gift. He really is. Everyone deserves to meet this guy and get to know him. And, of course, the great guitar playing you hear on that song is by the legendary Tommy Emmanuel, who's been a good friend and mentor to me. Time Sweetened Lies was the first time we worked together, the early 2000s. And as busy as he was, he gave me a whole weekend of his time, and he plays guitar all over that album and my second solo project, Limited Edition Prince, spelled P-R-I-N-C-E. Tommy's always been generous with me and so supportive of my music, and that was just another instance of his generosity in my life, and I am forever grateful. That's also his unmistakable laugh at the end of that song, where he laughs at that last guitar strum there. As always, visit my website at unhitched.com. I got to plug that. That's why I'm doing these podcasts. I'm trying to make folks more aware of what I'm doing. You can get my artwork, my writing, my books, and my music right there at unhitched.com, like unhitching a trailer. Thank you all for being there. I appreciate you, cousins. Take care of each other. Use your powers for good and enjoy the ride. We'll see you next time on Resisting Enlightenment.
So what did you learn?
You know, I didn't learn a damn thing.